Well, I feel stronger already. We're here at Mike Peschler's Athletic Strength Training Center, and we're going to sit down and talk with him about how things work and how people work out here. I'm looking forward to it.
Hi, Mike. Thank you for having me here today in your gym. It's really a remarkable place to come and work on athletic strength, as it's called athletic strength training.
Correct. Thank you, Cheryl. It's a pleasure to have you.
Yes, I am eager to learn more. But first, let me ask, what is your connection to Hopkinton?
I moved to Hopkinton when I was 16 years old in 1998, I believe it was. Okay. So from my sophomore year to graduation, I went to Hopkinton High School. Mm-hmm. I played football, basketball, and baseball there.
Wow.
And then I went to Bridgeton Academy to play football for a year, and then mm-hmm. to Sacred Heart for 4 years of football and sports management degree.
Wow.
And then after that, I moved back, and my sons are still in the school system right now.
Your sons are?
Yeah.
Yes. And how old are they?
They are 8 and 6.
Uh-huh.
So third grade and kindergartner.
Are they a growing athlete?
They are growing athletes. My son is playing flag football right now, which I'm helping coach.
Oh, wow.
And then my younger son, he's a T-ball guy.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Well, you have a lot going on with your family and your work, and it's all tied, connected with Hopkinton, and you have the center over in Ashland. So you are, I understand you're very still connected to Hopkinton, involved in different races that are going on, community events and clients.
Yeah, correct. Yeah. So I started in Hopkinton. I've been doing this for over 5 years, and I started in Hopkinton. I've had two places in Hopkinton and mm-hmm. just worked out that I'm in Ashland now. Mm-hmm. But I would say 95%+ of my clients are Hopkinton based.
Yeah.
And
mm-hmm.
I do stuff with them at the library fundraisers and local 5Ks, and just to help support the community as well.
Yes, yeah. Well, it sounds like you're very active and really working in ways to help many people and athletes and beyond
right.
live and be more athletic and live better lives, right? I'm curious about the start of this center. I want to read all the inspiring quotes, but I wonder, how did you get started with this?
Yeah, so that's a long story, and there is definitely something to it more than just wanting to be in business in a gym. Part of the reason, well, major reason why I got into the training was because, you know, as I was a pretty good athlete, mm-hmm. I still didn't work hard enough at it, and I had deep regrets after my playing career. So I played at Sacred Heart in my college crew, which is a small Division I school, but, you know, deep down I know I could have done better. Mm-hmm. I could have played at a higher level and just had a better career.
Mm-hmm.
Because I just kind of showed up and played my hardest, but on the off seasons I didn't always hit the weight room enough and just didn't do enough to become a better player. So after college I started going to this gym in Everett called Total Performance Sports, and when I went there I really learned how to properly train and actually found a love for it. And the other thing I learned, I like to read and learn about training. So I never really had that spark or that passion about anything until I started reading about it. So through training there and then experimenting with myself, I went through a couple of tryouts and did really well, but it was a little bit too little too late. So if I had been doing this earlier, it would have been a lot better. So for it was a time when nothing happened out of that, and I regretted it a lot, and definitely had, you know, it took me down a little bit. But the more I thought about it and was influenced by others that I was learning from, I was like, I can actually take this and prevent this from happening with other people.
Wow.
So it all started with, you know, high school athletes and all that. That's how it started. And where I started was a under 400 square foot shed in my ex-in-laws that had a wood-burning stove for fires
uh-huh.
in the winter time. So it's a very primitive start, but anybody and everybody that was there, like, it holds a special meaning to them because it just felt so, as they call it, you know, old school. And you know, everyone's in these fancy gyms now with air conditionings and all the machines. You know, we had free weights and some strongman equipment and just worked hard, and the kids got a lot better, and each year I got a few more people here and there.
In the shack.
In the shack, yep, as we call it, the shack. Yeah. Yeah, so I was there for about 2 years.
Well, sounds a very intimate kind of learning experience to learn about athleticism and using the mind and the body together, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And so that's how you got started and then move forward beyond the shack to a larger space.
Yeah, so after that, I moved into Hopkinton to a space that was about 800 square feet. More room. Mm-hmm. So, you know, at that time when I had a bathroom and heat, I started getting some more females coming in, which was good. So to get the diversity going a little bit. And I was there for 2 years and it started growing. And then I just came to the point where I had to get out and get a bigger spot. And then I found the place in Ashland, which is a lot more spacious. Got two bathrooms and showers.
Wow. And showers even.
Yeah, showers even, which is a big upgrade from where I started. But so far so good. I got more room and I'll be able to touch a lot more people this way.
Yes. How did you get your first client?
Well, I was lucky enough to one of my coaches, his name is Phil Shalosky, he's a town guy too. So he was one of my coaches at Hopkinton. Mm-hmm. And at the time when I was starting was the head coach at Nipmuc. Mm-hmm. So once he found out I was starting this, mm-hmm. he immediately got me like five or six guys, his son included and some of his football players. Mm-hmm. So as soon as I got them, we just started going and it just grew from there. So I was definitely fortunate to be, you know, have the connections, but once we had it, we worked hard and they had fun and got results.
Wow, it's quite a remarkable story how, you know, you came upon this path for your career.
Yeah.
Right? And maybe looking back with regret, but also forward learning and how to make something of this, which is really important. It's part of all of our life work, really, in a way, and you made it happen. And with that first client in the little shack, and here you are. And what are some of your programs now that you offer?
Well, I do mostly group training. So it's small group training, anywhere from 2 to 8, maybe 10 people at a time. I do offer one-on-one, but it's very minimal. And what I offer is individualized group training. Mm-hmm. So that way every person has a clipboard with their specific workout. And there might be a couple people that have the same workout, but this way it's not a cookie cutter program where, you know, a lot of these times just get one workout for everybody. And, you know, if that's, you're in for that workout, that's what you get. Mm-hmm. So I'm getting away from that and giving people what they need for their current abilities and their current levels to progress to whatever their goal is. Is that to get a scholarship or is that to be able to pick up your granddaughter and, you know, and take the groceries in easier? Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, it all revolves about becoming stronger and better shape.
Mm-hmm. So your age range, this is not just for athletes,
No.
And the age range could go from?
It can go from, I got 7th graders to grandmothers, so everybody.
What's a grandmother?
like 68.
Well, that, that's great to be offering something for people throughout life to work on strengthening the body, which is important. We kind of forget about that and the sit-down society.
Yes.
Right. And so I am dealing with some osteoporosis now. Is that something that I could work on?
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, the strength training builds the bones. So every time you get that stimulus, the bones become stronger.
Yeah.
So, and that and just be able to hold the body in good posture and, and feel confident will absolutely improve all that.
That sounds exciting to be offering to a community out there. Can we give a few things a try?
Absolutely.
I'm not an athlete, mind you, but I'd love to see what kind of work you do for beginners.
Absolutely, we can do that.
Okay, great.
All right, we're gonna go over three basic things that every person that comes to athletic strength training is going to do. We're gonna talk about breathing and bracing, stretching, and weight training. So the first thing I want to go over is breathing and bracing, which is super important if you're going to be lifting weights or anything where you want to protect your back and create good core strength.
Bracing, so, you mean what?
So I mean actually creating tension in the muscles, pressing the abs out, so that way you're prepared to lift the weight safely. And then you're also using all your core muscles when it's
you know, when you're not typically think you're going to. Okay, so it makes you safe and allows you to lift a heavier load safely. You know, and that's all relative to the person training.
Okay.
So I just want to see you take like 2 or 3 deep breaths and see what we got.
Okay.
Good. One more. Good. And you're doing a very good job because I see you filling the deep diaphragmic muscles up first instead of being like a typical person nowadays, just breathing, fills the, you know, their chest up and then blows out. So this is very healthy for us and it's gonna work those deep diaphragmic muscles. So that's a very good start. So normally I teach people suck in through the nose, fill in the belly into the chest, and then blow out. So it's super important to get those muscles strengthened, but also when you wanna cool down and stretch, this is how we count our stretches, not just for time, but relaxing the muscles and actually getting a good stretch. So next, we're gonna talk about bracing. So I want you to push into my belly, no punches, please. Push in nice and tight.
All right.
So what I'm gonna do when I brace is I push out I push out the abs to create like my own belt.
Yeah.
All right, so just as you can.
That's pretty tight there.
Yeah.
Okay. Can I do that?
Yeah. Ready? There we go. Push out, so relax.
Like
that's all right. Everybody starts somewhere. So why don't you relax, and now push out against it. There we go. All right, so you can kind of liken it to opening a tight jar or getting braced for a punch. So anytime, even doing a curl, you don't want to be lazy and going like this, your spine's out of alignment, so we're going to be nice and tight. And like I said, we're going to be working all those deep core muscles.
Good.
All right? So that's going to go into everything we're doing. Now, the next thing is stretching. I'm going to show 2 stretches that are great for anybody that sits down a lot.
Yes, that's me.
Dries and basically anybody these days, so we can't avoid it. So the first one, going to get the hip flexor. I'm gonna put our back foot on the bench, start bent over, and then we're gonna open up our chest, push our hip forward, and we should get a nice stretch in there. So this goes back to the breathing. Now, suck in, blow out. With each deep breath, the muscles get a little bit looser. You can also raise your hand for a little more of a stretch. So why don't we do that one first? Now we just do a couple quick deep breaths. You can feel those muscles relax. All those tight muscles loosening up. Very good.
Yeah.
So next thing we're gonna go into.
Okay, now get up.
Get up. Nice and gently.
All right.
The next thing we're gonna go to is one of the main strength exercises that we do. And
wow,
this is the deadlift.
Pretty heavy.
I know it might look a little intimidating, right? But when you think about it, you're always picking stuff up off the ground or off the table all day, every day. So it's good to train the body. So what we're gonna do is pretend like the bar is going across. We're gonna get it right over where the shoelaces would be. So then we're gonna push our hips back.
Okay.
Get tight. So now we're gonna, the breathing and the bracing comes into place now.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm gonna get our deep breath into the belly and get tight. Stand up.
Wow.
Then we're gonna go back. And then we'll do another rep. And stand up. So you notice every time before I went for a rep, I fill the belly up, brace the abs.
So this is like 500 pounds?
This is 2,000 pounds, so it's be a world record. This is about 70 pounds here, but eventually, just slowly and surely, we add weight as you get stronger.
Wow, okay.
All right, so we'll get this straightened out. There we go, let's point the toes forward about shoulder width. Looks like we're in a good position with the bar.
Right.
So why don't we start pushing our hips back. Yep, bend it down, grab the bar. Good, let's flex the back a little bit. There we go, now get that belly full of air. Brace the abs, stand up. Boom.
Aha.
Good, go back down.
Did it?
You did it, with ease. Let's do one more, fill the belly nice and air. Get tight, stand up. Good, and the back's nice and flat and strong.
Yeah.
Very good.
I like it.
Yeah. Very impressive for the first time.
I'd like to do more.
Well, let's go get some weight,
but
load it up.
About talk. Yeah.
Very good. So that's, you know, basically
wow,
a good start to what kind of things we do.
It's you know, it's doable.
Yeah.
Even though I don't do sports or I'm not typically athletic, it's comfortable and it's fun.
Right.
So how do you feel now?
No, oh, that was great. It felt good. I truly did feel stronger.
Yeah.
I lifted this. What do you call this?
It was a trap bar deadlift. Yep.
Yes, a trap bar deadlift.
Yeah.
I lifted it and it was 70 pounds. I feel successful. I feel like I'd like to keep going, actually.
Right.
And I know that's important for all of us to be feeling stronger in our bodies for as long as we have them.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah, that was terrific. Thank
you. Good. You did a great job, too.
Thank you. So now you see different clients and you have different kinds of programs for people to work on as well, right?
Correct.
Uh-huh. Yes. How do you get people, as you were talking about, to focus on that, the attitude also as a part of the physical component that you said was missing sometimes for you? I don't know if it was attitude or, you know, how do you include the thinking part?
Right. Well, I just try to be, I think one of the most important things I can do is lead from example.
Yeah.
So for one, you know, I keep in good shape myself and am able to do everything I have other people do. And I tell people my story. I tell them, you know, like, you know, look, you got one time and it's up to you. Mm-hmm. You know, you can think there's going to be instant gratification, you can blame your coach, you can say my parents don't help me out or whatever, but when it comes down to it, the only person that's going to make a difference is you. So
that's,
I just try
message.
To, yeah, I try to stay on top of people, and when it comes down to it, especially the people that are paying for it themselves, you know, why are you going to come to see me
right.
and pay me if you're not going to actually put the effort in?
Mm-hmm.
So it's more of just constantly reminding, and sometimes, you know, I have those days too where I'm not as motivated, but you just got to get on them and, you know, tell them, let them know it's more of a punch card kind of, punch the clock kind of deal. You know, you may not have the best workout every day, but as long as you keep doing it, good things are going to happen.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a great message, and it's about discipline, self-discipline, right?
Also. Absolutely, making the commitment.
We need more of that, I think, out in society.
I believe you're right.
I was wondering, for in terms of athleticism, athletes, you know, we hear the growing concern school-wide and out and beyond about injuries, head injuries, dealing with soccer and football, and poor sportsmanship also, whether it's in high school or, you know, we're talking about things like Deflategate we've dealt with.
Right.
And I wonder, what do you teach and what do you, in terms of athleticism and sports, what is important for us to have sports in the
right.
world and be athletic minded?
Right.
You know, when people might be taking it down. As we're more of a sit-down society.
Right, right. Well, I mean, I think sports is super important, and it creates passion. So, like, sometimes bad sportsmanship happens because of passion. I don't like to see it. I like, you know, I like seeing people that are competitive, but, they, you know, they're not going to be, you know, bad to the other teams. Mm-hmm. But, you know, this is going to happen from time to time. You know, one of the bigger things I'm more concerned about, like when you talk about the injuries and stuff like that, I think a big issue is parents focusing and specializing their kids in sports way too young. We have these club teams that are playing soccer all year round, and these kids aren't even in middle school yet.
I think the biggest thing is to expose them to as many sports as possible.
Not only sports, but activities.
So,
like,
drawing, singing, acting, whatever it might be. So they have to be athletic, but they have to be creative too.
Yeah.
You know,
so
you don't want one-minded people. And I feel the kids become a slave to their sport, and they might not really be into it, but do they have a choice?
No.
And that also slaves the parents to be driving their kids to all these sports all year round, where you're not really being a family at that point. And I mean, you are, but, you know, like, you should have some freedom to do some things on your own. And I think sports is super important. But like, have some variety. And you get to high school, and that time you're ready to specialize, that's another story. But I think people try to have their kids grow up too soon.
Yeah.
And that's where, you know, they should, you know, people should be doing something like this with their kids.
Mm-hmm.
We can do stuff with sixth graders and below that has no, it's all body weight stuff. I mean, people start gymnastics, what, 2 years old, maybe younger? That's strength training.
Mm-hmm.
Don't quote me on those ages, but that's all strength training. That's a great way to start kids with it. But like, you can work on your push-ups and pull-ups and sprint mechanics and all this stuff. And doing so helps the body be stronger and prevent it from injuries. So that's one of my biggest things is just...
Well, that's different for some of the advice out there. And it sounds very important, you know, to make yourself... give yourself the opportunity to try different kinds of athletic endeavors, whether they're competitive or you go hiking, and then you stay connected to family. Also, you don't lose sight of what's important in life while you go and explore sports, and you love life at the same time.
Exactly, 100%. Yeah,
so you're a philopher. I guess you could say so. Well, that sounds like really great advice. Yeah, I could see a good class for parenting. Maybe you could do like strong parents.
There you go.
Yep. And you know that because you're a parent yourself.
Correct.
It's a lot of work, but to make the most of it, because you know, as I can attest to, those parenting years fly by. It's a broad picture. It's not just to get really good at football and that's life, right? Well, I'm glad that you're out there teaching that. We have just a few minutes left. I was wondering, what would you say you learned from your clients, and what do you find rewarding about this work?
There's so many different things you learn from your clients, because everybody has a different background, different story, and I learned you can't judge the book by the cover. People surprise you in many different ways, whether it be what they've been through in life, what they can do physically in the gym, what their strengths and weaknesses are. So, you know, the beauty about how I do it with the individualized group training is it's never a huge group, and we get to talk and get to know each other, so it's not like, you know, their client A, B, or C, you know, they're Vin, Michelle, Tom, and so on. So you get advice from them, they get advice from me. I feel like a psychiatrist at times, but then I talk to them too. So it's definitely...
There's relationship.
Yeah, and there's wisdom from other people and all. And rewarding-wise, that's the biggest thing. Like, that's the biggest, because you can see a kid that has a scholarship opportunity now, and you know, you can see somebody that's just been sitting down and has trouble moving around to now tell me how easy it is for them to shut their well or just move stuff, where it was like, oh, that would bring the groceries, would have tired me out for another hour. Now I just bring them in like nothing. I see how much I can get in, I can play with my kids more. And
that's great. You hear a lot of good news from
and it just makes
people loving their life as well.
Right, and people don't realize how much they actually need it and how much their body actually wants to do it. There's a lot of bad habits that were created in the society, and everyone thinks it's normal when it, you know, you just got to get up and move a little and feel a little better.
Mm-hmm. Good advice. Do you have any overall philosophy for living a good life? I know you've given a lot here. Any one thing you would put it down to a phrase? Or
to do what you love.
Do what you love, yeah.
Otherwise you're wasting your time.
Yeah. And you have a training blog on your website here, I understand. What would be the book that you'd like to write if you had opportunity from doing a little bit of writing here with the blog?
Right. Oh, man. It would be about life and just be open and be trying new things and just not be so single-minded and just like inspiring people, because, you know, I love doing the gym, but I don't want to be doing it in this capacity for the rest of my life. I just want to help people and influence them, and make them enjoy life and working out and all that fun stuff that I enjoy already.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's terrific, and you have certainly inspired me in this brief time of interview today and in my workout.
Yeah.
So I'm looking forward to getting into some more as well. Thank you for
that
inspiration. And when you have a little time off, what do you love to do? Otherwise,
spend time with my sons. I do Spartan races. I read. I cook. That's about it.
A lot more.
Yeah, there's more to it. You know,
yes.
Challenge myself different ways.
Mm-hmm. Well, that sounds wonderful, and I wish you wonderful career while you're working here at the center. It's a fantastic space with opportunities for everyone and a good life forward as well. Thank you for inspiring me today.
No problem. Thank you.
Do you have what it takes?
Will you make a difference?
Always an adventure.
Police and fire working together.
Utilizing the latest technology.
Do you have what it takes?
My name is Margie Wiggin, and I want to invite you to join me for my new show, Character Matters, on HCAM. We're going to talk about why do people choose the behavior that they choose? Why do they choose to be good? We're going to hear from people in history, we're going to hear from local heroes who make great choices, and we're going to hear from some puppets who talk about things they've seen, and they're going to say, what? Did you see that? Yes, I did. Please join us.
Have you ever considered texting and driving? If so, you should know the consequences. If caught texting and driving for the first time, you could get an $100 fine plus your license taken away for 60 days. The consequences only get worse the more you get caught. Even if you don't get caught, there could be serious effects. You could get into a car accident and hurt yourself or someone else. Texting and driving is a very dangerous combination, so stop before this happens to you.
This show often talks to people who have interesting hobbies or careers or different things that they have going on that affect our community.
I'm Mary Arnott, your host.
There is a huge need for providing food for individuals and family.
And that's the key.
That's the key.
It's working well together.
You can see more episodes online at our website, hcam.tv.